Right. Hello. I'm Ari Kulmala, representing TII, the Technology Innovation Institute of Abu Dhabi. First, who are we? We are an applied research center focused on the leading edge technology research. We work with a lot of exceptional universities, the academia, and other partners around the world. And where we come, I come and our team comes here is the Secure System Research Center inside the TII. What is our mission? We drive the zero trust end-to-end security. So it means that we start from the chips and we go all the way through the chipset, embedded software, to virtualized software and applications to show that the concepts actually work in practice. Where do we contribute in the Secure Systems Research Center? We work with many different ecosystems. We have autonomous systems where we work with drone code, PX4, for instance. Then we work with the machine learning, secure platforms, and the kind of like baseline secure technologies as well as secure wireless. Well, so we are actually doing very, very wide collaboration with the different ecosystems and universities of the world. So as you can see here, we have partnerships with over 70 universities, for instance. And that's to kind of like, we want to focus to carry on the leading research and development in the certain areas. And our role in the applied research is to put together then the systems to show that they work in practice, build some kind of some proof concepts and drive the research from the kind of like practical approach point of view also forward. So this is one example of what we do. So like the topic of the talk was we work with the drones, for example. It's one application and we do everything there, or we can do everything there by ourselves. So we do the mechanics, we do the PCB, we do hardware design. In this particular example, we use the PolarFire SoC. And then we do the software on top of that. And then if we go forward from the flight control, which was just shown, we've worked with the whole autonomous drone system. So you have edge drones and the fog drone. The fog drone is a kind of like main drone that can control the edge drones. Edge drones kind of report to the fog drone, and then the whole swarm is controlled from the cloud, where you get the kind of like exact mission plans and stuff like that. And if you think about from the hardware point of view, you have the typically separation to flight control and mission computer computing. The flight controller being this kind of an autopilot that handles the sensors and keeps the drone in the air, and the mission computer is then the more of the brain that handles the autonomous operations like object detection, object avoidance, and these kind of operations that need much more performance. So flight controllers typically are such devices that can be run on MCU type of devices, and then for the mission computer, you actually need to have high-end performance. For instance, commercial platform from Qualcomm, RP5, RP6, and then from NVIDIA are used for these purposes. And if we go forward, like dive into the SoCs themselves, from the point of view of the RISC-V CPUs that are in this kind of integrated device, if we will put the flight controller and the mission computer into the same SoC, so you actually end up having quite a heterogeneous set of different processors. You need to have asymmetric multiprocessing capabilities. So if you start from the left, and this for the SoC, so things that you need because of the kind of like controlling the SoC, not the application itself, but there's the typical system control processor that and the secure CPU that handles the system controls as whole. So the maybe the most important part of the SoC to get it right, because it has access to everything, it can do everything in the chip in principle. Then you might have this kind of sensor hub CPU for power saving purposes. Then when you go forward for the PX4, the applications, you need a little bit less performance, but higher you go in the application requirements, the more complex the software will be, and you will be ending up having this kind of, well, virtual machines and hypervisors, and you need to make all these guys to talk each other. And what's the kind of like effect on the security? So this is an example how we do the security in this RISC-V based application browser subsystem. So we start from the hardware. There we of course have RISC-V cores. We have IO PMPs. We have the root of trust, and we can build the trusted firmware. From that we can go up in the layers. We have the hypervisor that will handle the virtual machines, and the virtual machines are isolated by the physical memory protection, so that whenever you launch the virtual machine, you allocate through the PMP the area where it can work on from the memory, and then you use MMU actually inside the virtual machine to isolate between the processes. And then you of course need to have similar kind of controls also for the peripherals. So things are complicated, and then you add more complexity when you take into account that you actually have many other kinds of processing elements also in the SoC. We want to do the image processing, for example, so then we will need the image signal processor, we will need the vision DSP, we will need audio DSP, we will do this kind of a sensor fusion using the AI engine. And actually you need to have similar kind of protections for all of these much more heterogeneous processing elements. And on top of that, you will likely have GPUs and DMAs, this kind of hardware-oriented blocks, which also have access to memories. So this means that the security controls, they in the complex chips, they are all the time becoming, well, more complex to handle also, because with the AI core instance, your IPR might be also your the network that you are running. You may want to protect your weights. You need to have secure storage for certain data. In the SoC, in the actual product development, you need to enable secure debug, which may mean that you need to bypass the security controls at times. It might mean that you, for instance, need to store certain debug-related data over the reset, which you wouldn't normally, of course, do. And you would need to be able to, in the field, be able to disable this kind of mode, but be able to use it in the R&D, etc. And this is to show that kind of like when you move from the CPU domain to handle the full SoC, it's coming very, very complicated. There are loads of things that you need to take care of also after that. And we heard in the morning the talk from the OpenTitan, and it's good that it's going also to the direction that you actually take into account the like secure channels for communication between the processor elements, etc. The point here in the last bullet is that it's critical to design the security early on, because the SoCs, they are so complicated that if it's an afterthought, you are likely going to miss something. And if you are going to do it in hurry after you have actually done the application, you are likely going to be doing something wrong. So what we are trying to protect, against what kind of attacks? So there are loads of those. So some of those are listed here, and some of the mitigations that we know. So you can attack the software, you can attack the like cryptography, the protocols, the hardware. You can use differential power analysis, probing. There is a lot of different kind of attacks that clever people can come up with. And over time, you can find the mitigation, but typically you have the attack first. So putting this together with the complex system design, it's driving us to the direction where we want to go. So So for our SoC development, we are heavily steering towards this zero trust, which means that we actually cannot trust the components of the system, even if we have previously found out that they are trustable. The next time we interact with the component, you shouldn't be trusting it anymore because somebody may have violated the or found some fault, made the security breach there. This may mean also, like if you think about the memory isolation, for instance, even if you are perfectly fine with the system that you have designed, you need to be ready for the fact that somebody will break your MMU. So what do you do next? Well, you want to kind of like contain the damage, try to limit the borders where they can access so that they wouldn't be able to access the root keys, for example. So need to be very, very careful on that. And probably you would like to add some maybe duplicate access controls just in case. For example, on addition to the MMU MPUs, you would add the World Guard technology that is submitted by Sci5 to the RISC-V community in order to have access control, another layer to protect against the breaches that you are having in the MMU or PMB side. And there are some examples of the research topics that we are doing in this area with the, some of the universities that were showing earlier. So we want to secure the whole chain, and in the silicon side it starts with the supply chain. So how do you make sure that the chips are genuine, so that the chips are the ones that you actually designed them to be? Then it goes to the hardware itself and the software. So control flow, integrity, confidential computing, authentication of the different blocks of the design, runtime assurance, so that you can somehow, it's similar to control flow integrity perhaps, but you can somehow monitor complex functions, whether they are producing something that is sensible. Like that you would, in case of drones, you would know that you cannot kind of like break the laws of physics. So if somebody is attacking your sensors, you have somebody who's telling you that this cannot be possible. So let's do now something and park this device and let somebody check whether everything's okay. Or then just break the device and tell that now game over. Well, side channel resistance, especially in the quantum computing, I think there is lots of to do in this area. So where you, if you can fight for instance this kind of differential power analysis attacks against quantum, they may be fairly vulnerable for those. And then what we do in the SoC area, then we bring in all the research from our partners. We do the test chips, and what's the ultimate purpose is actually that we want to SoC design to be designed like security first, so that we think of these complex scenarios and we do the security as the first priority, not the features or performance, but the security. And then the another thing is that we want to bring the innovation from academia to silicon products faster. So that's it. We are TII, Technology Innovation Institute. You can find us in the both in the like opposite side of the corridor. Thank you.